talks to the candidates vying for a spot on the County Board of Supervisors.
We take an in-depth look at health issues in Oskaloosa and Mahaska County.
And visitors to the Jackson Farm came from halfway across the world. We'll tell you why they're here.
From Oskaloosa's television news source, CRI Weekly News starts right now.
Good evening and thanks for joining us. I'm Amy Langdon.
And I'm Maureen McCamey. Our 2012 election coverage continues now with a profile of our weekly race of local interest.
This week we bring you more on the Mahaska County Board of Supervisors race. CRI's John Hoffman tells us more about the candidates, both of whom are natives of Oskaloosa.
The race for a seat on the Mahaska County Board of Supervisors is between Democrat Tom Riley and Republican Mike Vandermolen. I asked each of them about some of the projects that are facing the supervisors and what separates the two candidates from each other. First, the Southeast Connector Project, which is considering several different routes for a new road to connect the industrial park in Southeast Oskaloosa to Highway 63. The purpose of the project is to divert truck traffic around Oskaloosa instead of through it. Here's what the two candidates had to say about signing off on a project that could cut right through some residents' backyards.
You know, we need to make sure that we're respectful of property owners, but we need to continue to work with property owners and work with the county and work with the cities to make sure that we can get that project done.
I think it would take traffic from sort of our industrial park and bring it down to 63. This isn't the first time we've tried this project. We've worked with some landowners before. Some were on board, some were a little bit more hesitant, but we need to continue to work with them on our sites. Hopefully we can get everybody working together and we can get a good route that brings traffic down to 63.
Another big project is the regional airport. Like the Southeast Connector, the regional airport could require obtaining land from residents. A regional airport would be able to handle larger planes and possibly promote economic growth. Currently, the focus is to put the regional airport somewhere in between Oskaloosa and Pella.
I mean, a lot of people ask me if I'm in support of it, but we need to think about where this project already stands. Pella's already approved it, Oskaloosa's already approved it, and the Board of Supervisors has already approved it. So we're asking the wrong question. The next question is about process. I want to make sure that we don't use eminent domain to take away land from people. We need to make sure that this is a community project that everybody's on board with. So site selection is very, very important. I want to see the airport board negotiate privately with citizens and get this land and avoid taking land forcefully. Once you take land, you sort of get a us versus them mentality. And I think that could jeopardize the project. But I want it to be a community project if it gets done. But you have to do your initial planning very carefully. And so I want to be very involved in that. And I want to be proactive. I want to be on that board if I'm elected supervisor. I think that's important that we have a supervisor on the South Central Regional Airport Authority Board. So that will be one of my first actions if elected supervisor.
We need to start working together as communities, as a county, as counties, as a multimodal transportation area. So yes, if we can create, I think it's good government to have, rather than having a bunch of little airports around, if we can start moving in a direction to combining those airports in a more centrally located area, where two cities that don't need two airports, why don't we share an airport? I think that's better government, I think it's good government. And in the bigger picture, for economic development and job creation, when you start having a region that has a regionalized airport next to a four-lane highway, multiple four-lane highways, next to a rail intermodal, my God, whether it's agriculture, whether it's mechanical or industrial industry, jobs will be created.
Finally, what separates the two campaigns? Tom Riley cites his experience, while Mike Vandermolen says his motivation and preparation are what separates the two.
I've had to make tough choices in my own business. I was recruited to run for mayor. I'm very proud of the work I did as mayor. We created a paramedic level service. We had to do a lot of give and take on that. I helped work improve school infrastructure. It had nothing to do with the city because that's school stuff, but we worked together and we did a $26, $27 million school infrastructure project with no property tax increase. I'm very proud how we worked together on those types of things. Then I was recruited to run for the state senate. And I was very proud of the many pieces of legislation that we did there. Preschool is one I'm very proud of. And I'm very proud of the work I did as chairman of the transportation committee. I've met numerous contacts and numerous relationships that I've built over, and it has nothing to do with party, because I can tell you, I think the world of Chuck Gibb, director of the DNR. I think Secretary Bill Northey is a great Secretary of Agriculture. Lieutenant Governor Kim Reynolds, I sat with her. I mean, we talked on the Senate floor many times. In addition to my, a lot of the other, Debbie Durham with the Economic Development. So I want to take some of those experiences and some of the decision-making experiences that I've had to make, whether it's settling a $3 million budget or a $6 billion budget, whether we had to reinvest some of the revenues that we had, or we had to make tough choices when times were tough.
Yeah, I think there's really two things that separate me and my opponent, preparation and motivation. Since I announced I was going to run for supervisor last October, a year ago, I've tried to do as much as possible to learn everything I can about the county and the issues the county face. I've been to supervisor meetings since January. I've been to meetings concerning the airport board or the airport. I've been to meetings concerning the county dump. Just last week, I was at a meeting concerning economic development in the county and how we structure that with Oskaloosa. So I've tried to learn as much as I can so that when I take office in January, I hit the ground running and we can start to move things forward. It's very possible we're going to have two new supervisors sitting on the board. So I found it very important that I inform myself as much as possible. I think I owe that to the taxpayers. Also, motivation. I'm not coming from a higher office to a lower office. I got in this race myself. I wasn't pushed into it. At work, they always talk about complacency. And I think coming new on the board with not a whole lot of name recognition, sort of coming out of nowhere, I won't be very complacent. I will fight every day for the county, and I will work tirelessly to move things forward. So that we can help citizens both in the rural areas and in Oskaloosa and New Sharon and Fremont and all of the county.
Vander Mullen mentioned the possibility of two new supervisors on the board. Current Supervisor Ken Rosenboom is running to represent Iowa Senate District 40. If he wins, he'll resign from his supervisor position. That will then require a committee to be made up of the county treasurer, auditor, and recorder to make a decision. The committee would either appoint someone or call for a special election to fill the empty supervisor seat. Regardless, the face of the supervisors will look different come January, with either one or two new members on the three-person board. The only thing for certain is that one of the new faces will be Mike Vander Mullen or Tom Riley. For CRI Weekly News, I'm John Hoffman.
You can visit our website, CRITV.org, and click on the voter guide to watch the full interviews with both Riley and Vander Mullen. The two supervisor candidates were also in Smoky Row last night for a supervisor debate. The candidates agreed on the majority of the issues discussed, including Highway 63 improvements and looking into the idea of increasing the Mahaska County Board of Supervisors from a three-person board to a five-person board. One question asked was how they would specifically promote economic growth in the county.
I think one of the first things that we should do to promote economic development is actually sit down with our existing businesses. I don't think that happens all too often. I think everybody runs out there, wants to get that next great business to move into town. We have a lot of great businesses here in Oskaloosa and also in Mahaska County. But I'd like to sit down with our existing industry and our existing businesses. What are your needs? What are your challenges? Are there some infrastructure needs that we need to help you out with? Hey, are there some regulatory issues that are becoming burdensome to you that maybe we need to take a look at and reassess? I think, we also need to partner with the USDA. We need to partner with Mid-American Energy. We need to partner with NCRS. We need to partner with Debbie Durham and Department of Economic Development and utilize those tools and the many tools that they have in their bags to assist existing businesses and also expand business in our area. And again, it all comes back. I know I sound like a broken record, but it's going out there face-to-face with people, open up communication and listening.
Mr. Vander Mullen, 2 minutes is yours.
I was just at a meeting last week where we had various stakeholders there from the county and from Oskaloosa and Kioma Village and from a bunch of different areas. And we had a discussion about economic development in the county. We talked about how we're going to structure that, how the county is going to structure it, and how the Mahaska Community Development Board, how they're going to structure it. We didn't make any decisions, but we're going to push things forward a little bit. We're going to set a committee aside, and they're going to look at that. I think it's somewhat of a critical time. We're going to decide if we're going to have somebody dedicated to that for the county, if that's going to be separate from sort of the development group. But as concrete things on the ground we can do, one thing I would like to explore, and I can't promise it'll get done, but I can look at it, is a tax-recommended financing zone. A lot of times cities develop these, and counties don't too often, but the county does have it available. What you really do is you take the increased tax basis you see in a new business, and you end up giving that as a loan, and as those increased taxes come in, it pays off that loan. But it's something to look at. We could maybe bring in some new business, we could market it, but that's something, you know, discreet that I think is a possibility. It'd take a little work, but I'm willing to take the initiative to at least explore it.
It was a packed house in Smoky Row for the hour-long debate. The event was sponsored by CRI, the Oskaloosa Herald, KBOE, and Oski News. You can watch the full debate by going to CRITV.org and clicking on the voter guide.
In addition to profiling candidates, each week in October, CRI will focus on one of the main issues facing Oskaloosa and Mahaska County. This week, we took a look at health issues in the community.
YMCA Director Don Collins says only 14 other Iowa counties have childhood obesity rates higher than in Mahaska County. She says that this preschool swim class is the exception. Kids today tend to be less active than children were a few decades ago.
We ride more than we walk. If you think about the patterns of children walking to school, for example, from the 70s to now, we increasingly ride the bus. We will drive around a parking lot for 30 minutes, not literally, but it can feel like 30 minutes looking for the closest parking spot.
And Colin says adults have developed the same habits. So about a year ago, the Y partnered with other groups and businesses in town to try to make Mahaska County healthier. And the Mahaska Wellness Coalition was born.
We've all been engaged in wanting to improve health, and we all collaborate on different things. But we've never had intentional conversations just focused on health. It's part of everything else that we do. So coming together as the Wellness Coalition has really focused us.
One of the first projects the Wellness Coalition tackled was applying for Oskaloosa to become a Blue Zone. Healthway's Blue Zone initiative tries to make selected communities healthier by giving them grant money and program support. Last year, Oskaloosa didn't make the cut, but the coalition didn't give up. This year, it's been chosen as a finalist. Colin says the Wellness Coalition already has a few ideas in mind if Oskaloosa becomes a Blue Zone.
Looking at the city, the infrastructure, such as our sidewalks, which we actually have already started on, and then also looking at the schools and businesses, helping support our community with policy changes that we can make.
Another Mahaska Wellness Coalition member is encouraging healthy living in the workplace. Tiffany Tremmel works in human resources at Clive Elf.
We've got a full program that we do every year that kind of analyzes our claims and what we need help in the areas of wellness or our workforce needs help in. And then we take those particular items and then we focus on those during the year.
Tremmel says many CLOW employees enjoy the company's healthy living push. She says whether they're forming teams for a Live Healthy Iowa challenge, walking on their lunch hour, or heading over to the Y for an ab class, people at CLOW help push each other, and that's only the beginning.
We do things such as a yearly health fair. We do other things such as stroke detection screenings, also doing blood draws. Just general awareness issues, such as our stress-related month that's coming up.
But Tremmel says it can be a challenge to get everyone healthy.
You're always going to have, you know, some employees that don't want to change or just don't want to know, the bad things that might happen to them, unfortunately. But we try to put it out there, give them a little choice to know what, you know, how they can change and make their lives better. But there's always going to be, I think, a certain percentage that kind of resists that.
But the healthier CLOW employees are, the less money the company has to spend on health insurance claims.
Obviously, the healthier your employees are and the better wellness program you have, the better those insurance rates are going to be and less claims. Now, we do have an aging workforce. CLOW has been around for a long time. So, some of those changes and some of those wellness efforts, no matter how hard we try, some of those things just aren't going to change. But we're giving it our best effort.
While CLOW employees have health insurance, Mahaska Health Partnership Chief Operating Officer Aaron Baldwin says that's not the case for every patient select who comes through the hospital doors.
We see a wide variety from Medicare to Medicaid to private insurance to uninsured. I mean, we see the whole gamut of patient here.
MHP CEO Jay Christensen says the hospital treats all patients, even those who can't pay. But that means the hospital loses $2.4 million a year in bad debt or charity care. And making up for those expenses increases everyone else's hospital bills. Earlier this year, the Supreme Court upheld health care reform, including the requirement that anyone who can afford health care insurance must have it by 2014. Christensen says the more people are insured, the less bad debt hospitals will have, and the less everyone will have to pay to cover that debt. Healthcare reform also includes an expansion of Medicaid to help cover people who would otherwise not be able to afford insurance. And the Supreme Court says the federal government can't require states to participate in the expansion. It will take place in 2014, but there's no set deadline for states to decide. Some states have already decided whether to accept or reject the expansion. Other states, including Iowa, haven't made that decision yet.
If health reform stays on the same direction that it's going to, I don't think as an organization we have any choice but to continue to advocate for them to expand the Medicaid population. When you look at President Obama's plan, again, regardless of which party you support, it only works nationally if that expansion of Medicaid happens. Without it, really, we look at a much greater population of uninsured.
Baldwin says the hospital will continue to serve patients regardless of their insurance status. But she says MHP's current facilities aren't meeting the needs of patients or MHP staff.
The facilities that we have now are just really outdated. They don't make for the best healing environments for patients. They're not large enough for providers to work really well together in the room.
Now that's all changing, thanks to MHP's $22 million expansion wing. The space will house new, bigger inpatient and birthing facilities. Christensen says the new wing will help the hospital with another challenge, recruiting quality providers.
We've struggled to recruit enough primary care providers. And I think one of the things you look at with the purpose of a project like this is we're able to provide better, more effective care in a much more private environment for our patients. It's also a great recruiting tool. I mean, obviously, the ability to show a picture and say, this is what our organization looks like, this is where you're going to be able to come and practice. That's a great tool to at least get candidates here.
Ann Christensen says recruiting great healthcare providers is a step toward making MHP the first choice for Mahaska County residents.
We do compete for patients, and some of our competitors in the area have been expanding their practices in other communities. So yeah, obviously it is a challenge for us to keep patients here. And we have to do the best we can be to be cost competitive, to provide access in a time-sensitive manner for those patient needs, and also to provide the kind of service once they're here that they expect.
Representatives from the Blue Zone Initiative will be visiting Oskaloosa soon on Tuesday, October 30th. We'll keep you posted on the city's push to become a Blue Zone community. Tune in next week for our next in-depth issue story. We'll be taking a look at education. After a soggy week, a warmer weekend is in store. Here's your five-day forecast. There could be some good news on the way for those having trouble getting around town. Supervisor Ken Rosenboom mentioned at the end of Monday's supervisor meeting that the 1015 Transit bus service is working with Oskaloosa to have a scheduled bus route in town. The talks are preliminary, but the route could include a dozen stops to stores, the hospital, downtown, and more.
Hopefully we'll be able to announce that before too long that it's official. So.
Again, these plans are preliminary, but Oskaloosa could soon have a bus route that runs Monday through Friday from 8 a.m. to 5 p.m. The cost to ride is estimated at $2 per person. Also in the meeting, the supervisors continued talks about the Highway 63 improvement project. The project is currently in the study phases to select the best route and type of road from Oskaloosa north to Waterloo. Mahaska County is putting up $172,000 for the study. This amount will show the Iowa Department of Transportation that Mahaska County and its partners are committed to seeing the project through to completion. Area businesses and governments along the route will pay for half of the study, reducing the county's cost to $86,000.
The Oskaloosa Fire Department is asking for the community's help in finding a suspected arsonist. Fire Chief Mark Neff says two dumpsters were set on fire in the early hours of Thursday, October 11th. One fire spread from the dumpster to a boarded window and eventually inside an antique store at 203 High Avenue East. No one was injured, but the fire caused an estimated $30,000 in damages. Neff suspects foul play.
There's no other, you know, cause that we determined that would make us look otherwise. It's just that time of the morning, it's just pointing to arson.
Neff says another dumpster was set on fire at the intersection of J Avenue and Santa Clara on the same day. Neff asks anyone who has information about either fire to contact the fire department.
The recent rainfall was just enough to take the southern part of the county out of an extreme drought. The U.S. Drought Monitor shows that Mahaska County is now divided, with about half the county remaining in an extreme drought and the southern part of the county in a less intense, severe drought. The rain will help fill the soil profile, but it came too late to do anything for the corn and soybean crops. CRI Ag reporter John Hoffman has been following the crops on the Jackson's farm since the beginning of the season. He checks in again with the Jacksons as the harvest is wrapping up, but you'll never guess who else was there.
You won't need those gloves in here until later, so we'll be good to go.
Morning.
How are we doing, sir?
A group of 20 people from the Philippines made its way to Mark Jackson's farm yesterday.
The Filipino people as a whole are very friendly, very warm, and caring people. They remember clear back to the traditions in World War II and where our partnerships worked from that point. So good morning. Good
to
see
you.
Yes.
This group is comprised of leaders from 15 different companies that import soybean meal to their country to feed livestock. So in a sense, they're competitors, but collectively they work together as the Philippine Import Group to save money.
Were you guys worried about the drought at all? Have you been?
Yeah, that's why we're here. So we'll see how dry it is. So far, we've been hearing that it's doing pretty well. We'll see how it translates for the coming days.
Jackson's soybean harvest wrapped up much better than expected this year.
This is actually the best soybean average I've had in my 40 years of farming, despite the worst growing conditions.
The group was able to ask Jackson questions, take a look at equipment, crunch some numbers to try and get a better idea on what they might be paying for soybean meal that's made from soybeans right here in the Midwest and then shipped around the world to the Philippines, and see firsthand how U.S. agriculture is different from their country.
Big, big difference. We use horses to bring down the corn, for example, and here you have big trucks, so.
For CRI Weekly News, I'm John Hoffman.
Mark Jackson is the president of the Iowa Soybean Association, and that's why the group visited his farm. Earlier in the year, Jackson also welcomed people from China and Brazil. He says he's hosted delegates from about a dozen different countries to his farm now.
The annual coat drive in Oskaloosa will look a little different this year. New Hope Community Center is running the drive, taking over for the United Way. I stopped by New Hope to see what the change will mean to those in need as the temperatures drop.
This is our only rack of kids' coats, so we are in need of kids' coats.
Tanya Rice works at New Hope Community Center, a nonprofit that runs before and after school programs, as well as sells used clothing at deeply discounted prices to those in need. It's called the Clothes Closet, but this year, Rice got a new request.
United Way contacted us and asked us to do the adult portion of it, and then asked us to do the kids' portion of it, and I thought, yep, we have an extra room, we can do that.
So now if you need a coat for you or your family this winter, you can go here to get one free of charge. Rice says it's an important service to the community.
We find that people are struggling, so glad to be able to help people in that, you know, area. And I think people come in, there's a few that come in because they want to, but there's a majority of people that come in because they need to.
And the need isn't going away. Rice says she needs more coats, especially children's coats, as the weather gets colder.
There was so little at the beginning that I just began to put what the clothes closet had. We just need more because there's more people, you know, coming.
New Hope Community Center is located at 308 Fifth Avenue West in the old Jefferson School building. If you have a coat to donate or would like to receive one, you can do so Monday through Friday, 9 a.m. to 5 p.m. The Oskaloosa Public Library took a trip back in time Tuesday evening as it held a Tea and Talk book discussion. Residents came out in costume to talk about the book Lady Almina and the Real Downton Abbey. The book follows the family that lived in the English manor that inspired television's Downton Abbey before World War I, around the time the Titanic sank, through the war and into the 1920s. Central College professor Valerie Van Kouten led the discussion, giving insight into how life was back then.
So it's a great look at history and a great look at another lifestyle.
Van Kouten also brought some items from the time period to show off. She says the book talks about how the problems in the Middle East started around the end of World War I.
Well, the way the Middle East was divided at the end of World War I was not very fairly done. It was rather cut up rather arbitrarily, and it's caused a lot of the problems in the Middle East that we still have today in Egypt, in Syria, in Lebanon, in Iraq, and Iran.
The Friends of the Library hosted the discussion with leftover money from the Lynn Van Wielden Renner Memorial Fund. Halloween is only 12 days away, and Oskaloosa has some freaky fun in store. On Friday, October 26th from 6 to 8 p.m., Russell Wildlife Center is hosting an all-ages Halloween hike, complete with a prairie maze and a pumpkin decorating contest. If you want to participate in the contest, bring your own pumpkin decorated like an animal. Then on Saturday, October 27th, the Y is hosting its first annual Freaky 5K. The event starts with a 1 mile kids fun run at 8 a.m. with the 5K beginning at 9 a.m. It's $5 for the kids run if you register in advance and $10 the day of the race. The 5K costs $15 before and $20 the day of. Also on October 26th and 7th, William Penn is putting on a haunted house inside the McGrew Fine Arts Center from 7 to 11 p.m. Admission is free, though free will donations will be accepted. The event is open to those age 14 and above. Penn's haunted house will also be open on November 2nd and 3rd at the same time for those who missed it in October. And on Wednesday, October 31st, Main Street will host its downtown trick-or-treat parade at 4 p.m., traveling around the square and through Penn Central Mall. Then from 6 to 8 p.m. is the citywide trick-or-treat. Mahaska Drug is also welcoming trick-or-treaters inside its store from 5 to 7 p.m. that evening. To double-check dates and times of Halloween happenings, visit our website and click on the 2012 Halloween calendar article. When Oskaloosa made the trek to Pella for its Class 3A District 8 game, the Indians and their fans had to deal with more than just the Dutch.
Friday night's game lasted longer than expected after severe storms rolled in, forcing the game to be delayed twice. Nonetheless, Mother Nature couldn't stop either team from squaring off, as CRI and OSP's Jason Madison tells us.
Out of the gate, the Indians gobbled up 10 minutes after running 17 plays, but it was all for naught as the drive eventually stalled. After a scoreless first quarter, Pella countered with a 26-yard field goal and a 10-play, 99-yard scoring drive to go up 10-0 before halftime. After several Pella turnovers in the second half, Oskaloosa's offense couldn't capitalize on the Dutch's defense, falling 17-0. This was Pella's third shutout dating back to the last week of September. OHS sophomore Nate Van Veldhuizen led the maroon and white offense with 14 carries for 69 yards. Senior Brandon Strasser and Keoki Gibson tallied 11 tackles apiece. The Indians closed the season Friday against Knoxville on senior night. Kickoff is set at 7:30 p.m. at Lacey Stadium. The following day, the NAIA's fifth-ranked Statesmen dealt with the same inclement weather on the road, but came out on the winning end. Penn rolled over St. Mary, Kansas 53-14 to extend its winning streak to 7-0 for the second time in school history. Last time this happened was in 1975. This Saturday, WPU hosts its toughest competition of the year when number 7 St. Francis, Indiana comes to Lacey at 1 p.m. 2 weeks ago, St. Francis knocked off last year's NAIA defending champion St. Xavier before going the distance last weekend with the new number 1 Marion, Indiana. St. Francis led the entire game but couldn't hold off Marion, falling 45-38. For CRI Weekly News, I'm Jason Madison.
And that's our newscast for the week. As you know, we bring you the news twice a week. Visit our website, CRITV.org, on Wednesdays at 6 to watch our midweek newscast.
From all of us at the Communication Research Institute of William Penn University, thank you for watching. I'm Amy Langdon.
And I'm Maureen McCamey.
See you next week.
C.
Stay up to date on all the news happening in Oskaloosa by following CRI Weekly News Online at www.critv.org, facebook.com/CRI Weekly News, and Twitter at CRI Oskaloosa.